Okay, so I hope some family members will still come in, even though it's the 7-Eleven version, not quite from this point. So this workshop now goes to the full science mode for the afternoon, and we will run through these topics, which are of close to Fred's heart, or what he was interested in. So I hope people will stick to their times and try to keep it shorter, so that we can actually get to dinner tonight. But I'm a little worried. Anyway, first is Charles going to tell us about the early work on collaborations. This was on.
First of all, can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Good. So this is going to be primarily a science talk, but I will make a few comments on Fred. I actually met Fred in 1974 when I was a graduate student at Caltech, and he joined Caltech as a postdoc. But we didn't collaborate. We became friends. But our association really grew much more significant at about the time that he came to Asia A to assume the directorship. So I was thinking about how I was going to structure this talk, and I was going to think about this as the quiet influence of an influential director. Directors can do a lot of spectacular things, and Fred is certainly no exception to that. But a truly influential director will have left his or her influence very widely, often on projects that nobody associates with them in the first place. And I think one of the examples I'm about to give fits that very well. But it's actually rather strange to associate the word quiet with Fred. So I refer to this as the sometimes quiet influence of an influential director like Fred Lowe. And the two topics I was asked to cover, and these are a couple of two topics where there was overlap significantly with my interest. One is the submillimeter array, and the other is the survey of the Kuiper belt using occultations of bright stars. And I'm going to talk mostly about the latter, because the SMA has come up from time to time previously. Also, the SMA is, I think, better known. I think that's the thing we're bringing it with this down. So the submillimeter array is a project that was conceived in the late 80s and early 90s by folks in the Center for Astrophysics. And it was originally intended to be a six-element interferometer on the summit of Mauna Kea. And largely through the influence of this infamous cabal we keep hearing about that includes Paul and Typhoon and Frank and, of course, Fred, it was decided to make a collaboration between IAA and the Smithsonian Astrophysical Observatory to expand the array from six elements to eight, thereby almost doubling its speed as an interferometer. And that the agreement that led to that formally was signed in 1996, before Fred became director, but reflecting the influence that he and those three colleagues had. This is a panoramic shot taken by Nimesh Patel from the summit, taken at night. The red glow in the middle left is actually Kilauea. It's actually volcanic glow. You can see the JCMT and the CSO, and then scattered in the right half of the image are the eight elements of the interferometer. Up here close is the a couple of the actual elements. Jim Moran asked me to mention one particular feature of the story of creating these, is that the structure that holds the dish in the back plane is composed of carbon fiber tubes. And this the goal of fabricating these carbon fiber tubes was started and was pretty far along in Massachusetts. It's dangerous for me to talk about this in front of Paul, but what the hell. And it just really wasn't going well. I mean, there were just significant failure after significant failure. And Fred and the Asia A team said that they could get this done in Taiwan. And very quickly, they identified a manufacturer who was able to make those key parts. Basically, the key structural elements of the dishes were fabricated in Taiwan. So this is just another pretty picture of the submillimeter array. It's a highly functioning array now. Of course, it is very much in the shadow of ALMA. But for those of us who have privileged access to the submillimeter array, it turns out to be a great way of getting ALMA time. And that's reflected in the success of proposals from this institution and from mine. So that's what I really wanted to say in this early phase of the talk. Now I want to talk about something that probably many of you have heard of, but maybe I'm not as familiar with as I think you will become in the next several years. Let me try and explain that. So the Taiwanese American Occultation Survey was a collaboration institutionally between AsiaA, Yonsei University, the National Central University, and these represent the three different institutions I worked at during the conduct of this this project. I was at Lawrence Livermore Lab at the beginning, then moved to Penn, and then I took my present job at the Center for Astrophysics. And just to take a few minutes to give some science background, not to scale, but here's a cartoon of the large planetary portion of the solar system. It's now believed that there was significant migration among the giant planets in the first few tens of millions of years. Jupiter probably moved inwards a little bit. Saturn moved out. Neptune might have moved out as much as 10 astronomical units or more. And actually, it's the motion of Neptune that accounts for the capture of a significant fraction of the Kuiper Belt objects into this 3-to-2 mean motion resonance that Pluto inhabits. The Kuiper Belt is this now well-known belt of small icy objects. The first discovered member of the Kuiper Belt was Pluto, of course, in the 1930s. But the modern era started with Jewett and Liu in 1993, when they made the first detection of smaller objects, and now there are thousands of known objects. All of the objects that have been actually detected have been detected in reflected sunlight, and they're all larger than about 20 kilometers in diameter. We don't have good albedos, so we don't have good size estimates. It's believed that these bodies, many of them were formed in situ, but some of them were scattered out by the motion of Uranus and Neptune. And the motion of these planets collectively also scattered a very significant number of relic planetesimals after the other planet formation, some of which left the solar system altogether, but many others of which populated the Oort cloud, which is now known to extend to beyond 20 or 30,000 astronomical units, which tells us that the volume of the solar system is mostly unexplored. Right? So you've got this parts of the solar system we've actually directly detected. It just extends out to a little less than 100 astronomical units, whereas we believe the whole extends out to beyond 20,000 astronomical units. So it's of interest certainly to me and some of my colleagues to understand how to detect these objects and the physical processes that define their size spectrum, which is a mixture of early planetesimal formation, which forms a classic Q=5 slope, modified by collisional erosion over the 4 billion subsequent year evolution of the solar system, which brings the flattens out the size spectrum at the bottom end. All detection today can be made up here, and the occultation technique I'm about to describe is sensitive down at the bottom end. So it picks out a very different piece of the physics of the evolution of Kuiper Belt objects. This is a figure showing the distance to an object in astronomical units on a log scale, and the diameter assuming a 4% albedo, which is a reasonable mean albedo for these objects. And the red lines are lines of constant R magnitude in reflected sunlight. So this is R equals 20, this is R equals 30, 40, and 50. You can see all the known objects sort of more or less in the R equals 20 something range. But the interesting objects for understanding the evolution of the solar system are all down here, where they're just not going to be detected directly in reflecting sunlight. So an occultation technique, which is basically nothing more deeper than it sounds, where you count those instances where an object passes briefly in front of a background star, can in principle address what's going on down here, but of course with much less information per object than you get when you make direct detections and you can follow objects and get orbital elements. So I like to think that studying populations using indirect techniques like this is an act of desperation. You only do it if you really have no other choice. And so that's what this is about. The challenges, of course,
is that the events that we're looking for last typically less than a second, so we need to make photometric measurements rapidly. And you need to follow sufficient stars, and in the early days we thought 500 to 1,000 would be sufficient to make a credible detection rate. And you need to have a result at the end that when you write it up or give it a talk in public, that people will say, yeah, that looks right. It has to be credible. And credibility is a significant issue with very rare events. So what does an occultation event look like? Well, if you put a small spherical object, in this case I think this is a 1 kilometer object, up against a background illuminated by a bright star, you get this classic, this is a 5 kilometer object, you get this classic pattern with a bright crossing spot in the middle and a bunch of airy rings. And if there's relative motion between the object and the background star, you basically get a cut across this diagram. And that leads to a series of events of the kind shown here, where the underlying curve in blue is the infinitely sampled event, and the red square pattern is what you get if you sample at 5 hertz with one particular choice of offset. So you can see for a 1 kilometer object in the middle of the Clayton belt, you get a very modest reduction that would just be barely detectable in a credible way. But say with a 5 kilometer object at 500 AU, the event is stretched out substantially because the relative motion is slower and also because the Fresnel pattern is larger. So you get an event that can be very well sampled. We expected most of our events to be in this range, the 1 to 3 kilometer range in the Kuiper belt. I've been struggling to get a survey for this going for some time, working with a number of colleagues at Lawrence Livermore Lab, notably Tim Axelrod, and we frankly were not getting to any sort of critical mass in terms of collaborative power. And I visited the University of Illinois to give a colloquium, I believe, just a few months before Fred moved here to take his directorship. And I had the most astounding conversation with him. You know, I described what we were trying to do. And he said, oh, we can do that, just like that. Now, of course, what he really meant was that other people could do that. He was going to get in touch with colleagues back in Taiwan, in particular Typhoon and Wenping Cheng, who is at National Central University. And it was actually that conversation in Fred's office at Illinois that led to everything that I'm about to talk about that follows. So that's what I mean by quietly influential, because his name, except in an acknowledgement, is not going to appear on any of the papers. But in fact, none of this would happen if it hadn't been for Fred's recognition that there might be something interesting to do here, and using his influence to get it started. And Typhoon showed an image from the first excursion to the Lulin area of the Central Highlands, where we were frankly hiking around an extremely undeveloped territory to see where we might locate this system. So let me get a little bit into the details. The goal was to monitor up to 1,000 stars. We frankly never achieved that. But at 5 hertz sampling, so we needed a wide field of view, and we needed multiple telescopes to beat down false positives, because when you see a star blink out for a fraction of a second, you don't know whether it's an extreme scintillation event or a bat flying through the telescope beam. You need multiple telescopes to see something at once. We concluded 3 was the minimum. We ended up with 4. These are the telescopes we use. They're 50 centimeter aperture. They're actually in a shed just near the building right now. They've been removed from the site. But they were installed at the Lulin Observatory in the Central Highlands of Taiwan. Here is one of the enclosures. Here's another enclosure. Here's another one. The other one's over here. These are other facilities of National Central University. This system was up and running for an extended period of time. It never really had the sensitivity needed to detect credibly events from the Kuiper belt as we presently understand it. The expected event rate has now been revised down by subsequent information. And this system didn't actually perform as well as we had hoped. But it did actually make 5 hertz measurements on hundreds of stars at a time, using an innovative readout mode we call zipper mode. And just to show that it works, this is data from 3 telescopes simultaneously. And this was a predicted occultation of a star by an asteroid. So you can see that star there, it blinks out. We're just playing this backwards over and over again. So the system in principle worked, but it delivered not detections, but actually one of the better upper limits in the game. So this is the upper limit to the size spectrum of quad pivot objects in the range of 1 to 10 kilometers from TAS. These detections of brighter objects with from Hubble Space Telescope. And then there's a potential event reported by Hilke Schrifting and collaborators based on photometry done with the Hubble Fine Guidance Sensor, one event. So that's where we are to date. And TAS-1 taught us a great deal, served as a technology development platform. The real game is what's coming, the TAS-2, now known as the Trans-Neptunian Automated Occultation Survey, or TAS-2.
It's a collaboration now between Asia A, UNAM, and Mexico. We're involved, so we're not playing as large a role as these first two, National Central and the Canadian NRC. The goal of this new system is to move that upper limit down by almost two orders of magnitude, so that if there are detections to be made, they'll be made if the actual size spectrum exceeds this line. And to do that, a number of things have to be improved substantially. In particular, it has to be possible to follow 10,000 or more stars simultaneously with sampling at greater than 5 hertz. And the current technical spec is 20 hertz. It's going to be achieved with custom CMOS images, and I'll show you them. These were developed collaboratively with E2V by Xiang Yu and his team here at Asia A. And of course, the real tough challenge is to minimize false positive rate again, and that's going to be done by requiring coincident detection of events in multiple, in this case, 3 telescopes. So the telescopes are actually in an advanced state of development. They've been purchased from DFM Engineering in Colorado. They're 1.3 meter aperture, F4. And here are 2 of them in a relatively early stage of development, but they're pretty close to being ready to ship. This is the location of the site. Where this is an image of the northern end of Baja, California, in night. So here's Mexicali, San Diego, Tijuana, and Ensenada. You can see this dark space down here. It's actually really pretty dark there. It's a really good place to do astronomy. And it's one of the last great undeveloped sites in the world that's not in Chile for astronomy. And remarkably, very little astronomical development has gone on here. So this is where the 2-meter telescope is, the 3 TAS telescopes can be located here, here, and here, with a control building in the middle. And the construction is at a relatively advanced state. Here's the pier for one of the telescopes with the enclosure scaffolding. Here is Matt Lehner, who's basically making all of this happen, and his UNAM collaborator, Mauricio Reyes, and the local contractor, I think his name is Ruben Montez or Lopez. But they're actually in, at the top of one of the piers of these telescopes. The telescopes, they're quality, well-engineered telescopes, but they're not remarkable advances in the engineering. But the focal plane actually makes me really jealous. These are based on custom CMOS devices, which, as I remarked, were developed collaboratively by E2V under contract to Asia A. And there are going to be 10 of these per camera, and there are 3 of them. Each chip is 1920 by 4608 pixels, and they're 3-edge buttable. They're back illuminated, and they allow sub-aperture readouts. So you don't have to read out the entire chip. You can just read out windows around the target stars. And that's the way of controlling the read noise. They're achieving read noise in the range of 3 to 4 electrons with these devices, whereas the best we've achieved with the Teledyne devices, which is all we had at our disposal until recently, were between 15 and 18 electrons per read. The dark current is essentially negligible. So this is just a sketch of the device with the mounting pins below and some mounting hardware that's actually in this building, in the lab right now. And the data rate is going to be considerable with
10 of those chips per camera. That's 88 megapixels per camera. You're reading out sub-aperture in 3 telescopes at 20 hertz. So the image data is around 250 terabytes of raw data per month. So there's a very significant data processing challenge, which is the first stage of which will be handled actually at the summer. So the data processing challenge has a lot in common with what LSST faces. Smaller focal planes, but much higher cadence. In terms of manpower, well, the key individuals are Matt Lehner, who I believe is in the room somewhere. He's the big guy. He's the tallest guy in the room, whichever room he's in. Xiaoyu Wang, who's the project manager, and in addition, the 4 scientists, postdocs, and graduate students. There's a tremendous amount of activity going on right now. The schedule is to finish the telescope installation September, you know, coming up at the end of the summer. They're in an advanced stage, and to finish the cameras in early fall, in October, with data taking in November. Now, for those of us who care about the other solar system, this is a landmark moment. It's taken 20 years to get to this point since that first interaction with Fred, and then with Typhoon and Wenping. But this is a system that is very likely to make significant, credible detections of occultations of objects in the Kuiper Belt, and maybe even from the inner Oort cloud, which will greatly expand our reach into the solar system. So I'd like to say again, this is a tremendous amount of effort by a lot of talented people. You know, 2 decades of work at observing sites in Taiwan and now in Mexico. But I think it's fair to say that none of this would have happened without Fred's intervention at a key moment. And without the exercise of his influence as director, firmly and generously and quietly, to make something happen that is now actually coming to fruition, sadly, after he's passed away. So I miss Fred, as I think many of you do. Those of us in the Taos Project are eternally in his debt. And I think Paul is in my debt because I've used less of my time. Thank you.
Questions?
Do you have any plans to try to have time dependent for the occultation so you can tell the direction of the occultation or other information as you see the shadow move across the telescopes? I guess yours 3 now are too close together for that. Is that
right? Yeah, they're separated by a border 100 or 200 meters. So you don't get any directional information. We did actually think in the early days about laying the telescopes out over an extended range, so measured in kilometers. There are 2 challenges for that. One is that you need a place that's flat enough, and most observatories are up in the mountains. So it's difficult to lay your telescopes out in a line that's that long. The other is, because of the obliquity of the Earth, the trajectory of the shadow, so you have to be moving some of the telescopes every few months. So we abandoned that as a technical goal relatively early, just because it's too costly. In the event that this is successful, then we might, you know, future generations of experiment might come back and try that. So there'll be no directional information from this.
Charles, could you say something briefly about alternative discoveries made possible in transient astronomy or periodic variables or whatever?
Okay,
but, so could be added.
Yeah. So the light curves recorded here are taken at 20 hertz, which is substantially faster than typical stellar photometry. So they will be sensitive to phenomenology in that frequency range to a degree that, say, LSST just doesn't come close to. So there's considerable possibility for discovery. What it's not well suited to is serendipitous discovery of something like an optical counterpart to a gamma ray burst, because the windows are, we're not reading out the entire focal plane. The windows laid down are the known stars.
So it'll be great at doing high-speed photometry on the tens of thousands of known stars that are followed by the project. You just don't know where that's going to go. But the project is very sensitive to that possibility.
Did you ever discuss Taos 3 with Fred?
No. Yeah. We did actually propose to NASA a mission to do this from space. And in the recent discovery round, and the proposal was warmly reviewed but not selected. So this is the only game in town right now. But honestly, I think there's a very high probability that they'll make significant numbers of credible detections.
Any other question? Jeff?
My question is the same as Frank's.
Okay. Any other?
The serendipity is likely. Why did you say that?
Excuse me?
Yes, did you say that serendipity detection or something?
My anticipated. That we know a lot more about the Kuiper Belt than we did at the time we originally proposed House 1. The direct surveys have gone to much fainter limits, and the modeling for the collisional spectra. But for small objects, is much more advanced than it was when we started out. So within the reasonable range of theoretical predictions, for all of the well-known theoretical predictions, Taos 2 should make detections. Whereas that was not guaranteed when we set out to do Taos 1.
Okay, thanks, Charles.